Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Here with me today is Delia Milliron, the T. Brockett Hudson Professor of Chemical Engineering and the Bill L. Stanley Endowed Leadership Chair of the Department of Chemical Engineering at the University of Texas at Austin. So Delia, thank you so much for being here. Can you tell us a little bit about your research?
Sure. I work on nanomaterials, and I'm motivated by technologies that can save energy and generally help with the clean energy transition. We've mostly been focused, in terms of applications, on developing smart windows that can change the amount of sunlight, both the visible light and the near-infrared light that contributes to heating, dynamically. So the idea is to tune the transmittance of sunlight to manage heat and light in buildings to match our changing needs for those, which of course change with the weather, with the seasons, and so on. And in particular, we've been trying to find materials that can separate the control of heat and light, because our needs for those two things both change, but not necessarily in a correlated way.
So how does nanotechnology play a role in these windows?
So we make our coatings from nanocrystals, very small pieces of the active smart window materials. And their small size really fundamentally changes the way they interact with sunlight that gives us more control over the selectivity of the window with respect to visible light and to heating. For example, using nanocrystals unlocks what we call a cool mode of the window, where it still transmits most of the visible light that you can use to light your interior spaces, but it blocks as much of the heat as possible. The nanostructuring of our window coatings also speeds up the switching. So making them small allows them to more rapidly change their tint, which expands potential applications to things like cars or trains.
So does the switching between modes, is it a physical reorientation of the crystals that provides this change in tint?
No, actually, the crystals are stationary and they don't really change their shape or size in any particular way. What happens is we add and remove electronic charge, and we do this through an electrochemical means. And that means that the electrons are moving in and out of the material, and at the same time, ions are moving in and out of the material from an electrolyte or a salt solution that they're in contact with.
So is the structure of this window film like a battery?
Yes. So the active material that I've been describing acts like one electrode in the battery, and the opposite electrode in the battery actually can also provide a change in tint. So they work together in a complementary fashion. So what we're effectively making is a thin film battery where all the layers of the battery are spread out across the glass or across your window pane. And when you look through the window, you're looking through the complete battery stack, both of the electrodes as well as this electrolyte that facilitates the switching between the different modes.
So you have this transparent electrochemical cell that's part of the window that will let in light but not heat if you want to keep it cool, and let in light and heat, perhaps in the winter, when you want to keep it warm.
Exactly.
So what is the status of this technology? And when you're making this coating in this cell, how large can you make it?
Yes, so there are these so-called electrochromic smart windows on the market today. And in fact, they've been made at large scale. So for commercial buildings, you know, basically glassy skyscrapers have been developed with these windows in them. Unfortunately, they're pretty expensive, so they're not suitable yet for broad deployment in the market where they can have a really big impact on reducing energy consumption. So part of our goal is to use nanocrystals to reduce the manufacturing costs. So besides their interesting optical physics and electrochemical properties that are advantageous, they're solution processable, which means that it's much more feasible to make low-cost coatings. In my lab, we only make devices that are a few inches square to prove out the performance at that scale. That's big enough that we can share them with industrial partners and they can put them through their paces in terms of cycling them many times and heating them up and cooling them down through repeated thermal shock cycles to do the basic tests to see if the technology is worth advancing. But from there, then we have to adapt existing manufacturing processes that are used for solution coatings of other sorts to coat larger panes of glass. And so the prototype lines for these sorts of things are usually meter wide glass. And then you go up from there.
How do you physically do the switching from one state to another when this coating is part of a window pane, for instance?
That's a great question. So we need to get the electronic charge in and out of this transparent thin film battery. And so we have transparent conductive layers on the glass that carry that charge. And they carry it all the way across the pane to the edge of the window where metallic bars are hidden usually in the frame of the window. So you wouldn't see it when it's installed in your house. And then those could be hooked up to a control panel on the wall or even to a central thermostat that can holistically manage your air conditioner, your heater, your ventilation, and your windows all together to optimize the energy performance of the building.
And if these are intended to be energy-saving devices, how much energy does it take to do the switching?
It takes actually very little energy to switch the windows. So we've collaborated with energy analysis engineers who can model the energy performance of buildings and take into account the energy needed for switching. And it's less than 1% of the energy savings is required to do the switching. So it really becomes a negligible energy use. And part of that is because of the characteristics of the electrochemical device. Just like a battery holds its charge quite well until you use it, these windows, once you've set it to a given optical state, they don't consume any additional energy to stay in that state. So whether it's in the cool mode or what we call the dark mode, where it's also tinted to help block or control glare and further reduce heating, that state is stable. So only when you're actively switching to a different mode does the window consume any energy at all.
Have there been some findings that you and your colleagues found surprising or took you in a different direction than you had anticipated during this work?
We've had some really surprising findings that have motivated brand new directions in terms of materials development. So we've been working for a while on niobium oxide as a component of our active smart window coating. And this is a material that had really been written off as a potential smart window material, had been explored decades earlier and found to be quite inefficient. And we were using it initially just as a model system. The chemistry was feasible for the approach we were trying to take, and we just thought of it as a stepping stone. But what we found was that depending on the atomic scale structure of the material, it actually could perform five times as efficient as had previously been observed. So suddenly it went from being a real loser of an electrochromic material to a real champion. And in fact, its efficiency is now even two or three times better than the current commercial standard for these windows, which is tungsten oxide. So that's been a really exciting development. Niobium oxide also has other favorable characteristics in terms of its stability in UV light compared to tungsten oxide. So we're very excited about the potential now of niobium oxide as a prime candidate for commercialization of smart windows, which I would definitely not have expected when we first started down this path.
What is the availability or abundance of this material? We're certainly very acutely aware of critical minerals and scarcity in sourcing these days. Is it an abundant material?
Niobium is reasonably abundant in the Earth's crust, and it's also important when we analyze the potential cost of these windows and ability to meet large-scale market demands, that we recognize how much of the material is needed for a given window coating. So in the complete device that is the smart window coating, this active layer where the niobium would be is probably going to be only a micron or less thick. So it's much, much less material than you would need for batteries, for example, or for the magnets in windmills that we hear so much about with their need for rare earth elements. So it's a very thin layer. And in fact, the materials for the electrolyte, which is just a salty solution, are more critical in some ways than for the thin active coatings, because the electrolyte is probably going to be tens of microns or even hundreds of microns thick. So just several factors more material is needed, which tends to dominate over the scarcity of the individual components. Obviously, if we were talking about platinum or something, you know, incredibly scarce, that would change the math quite a bit. But niobium is reasonably abundant.
And what about the recyclability of these windows at end of use? Are you able to recover the materials?
I think it would be feasible. We haven't done a detailed analysis, honestly, at this stage. I would love to see more design for recycling and that kind of thinking going into technologies at the front end as we get further down the road with our industry partners into the fabrication processes. I'd love to get more into the recycling approach as well. In principle, it's feasible because the device is kind of a laminated stack. So there's nothing about it that would prevent it being kind of peeled apart. But again, designing in release layers and stuff like that to make the disassembly more readily possible, I think would be an important step.
So what's next? What are the future directions for you and your research in this area?
So far, we've mostly worked on the active electrochromic material, the material that's predominantly responsible for taking up an electronic charge and creating the optical tint. So the next steps are mostly about considering the system, so the whole electrochemical cell, and even beyond that, how does that active material become integrated with a counter electrode, for example, that has to balance its charge, but could also contribute to the optical tint and maybe give an overall better result in terms of the efficiency, in terms of the aesthetics of the coloration of the window, and how do the choice of salts for the electrolyte, for example, give us a new strategy for tuning the way that the materials interact with light. So a new way to tune the tint, to control separately the light and the heat. So the kind of system level design is the frontier for us at the moment.
Well, Delia, I've really enjoyed our conversation today and learning more about your smart windows. Do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with our listeners?
We should remain open and optimistic about the possibilities for technologies to be developed, the surprises we've had along the way in terms of unexpected performance of materials is kind of illustrative for me, but also about the potential for our society to change in ways that it needs to in order to progress towards a more sustainable future and a future where more people can live a good quality of life. I think that's possible, and we tend to get bogged down in the challenges and the difficulties. But I think if more people continue to believe that these things are possible and that they depend on just the choices that we make every day to help each other and to keep looking for better solutions, and that we'll be able to make progress.